Masechet Eruvin, Daf 68. We start off today with three stories of infants who needed to have a Brit Milah on Shabbat. And as part of that, they need hot water give them the bath right before the Brit Milah and right after. It was considered medically necessary for the health of the baby to have hot water. However, in all these three cases, the hot water that they prepared from before Shabbat spilled. And now they don't have any more hot water. So we saw the first case we started with yesterday was that they said, okay, so bring some hot water from next door. They said, oh, we didn't make an eruv. Okay, rely on the shituf. No, we didn't do a shituf. That's not good enough, so they can't carry the water. Instead, they ask a non-Jew to go and bring the water and carry it from a different place. And after some discussion, they determined that yes, it's okay to ask a non-Jew to do something because this is in order to do the mitzvah. They wouldn't be able to do the mitzvah would be too dangerous to do without the hot water. And so it's permitted to ask a non-Jew. Okay, we're going to have a little bit of more discussion about that case and two more stories about bringing hot water, either by having a non-Jew heat it up or by transferring it from another courtyard using the relinquishing model, relinquishing the property. That once we mention relinquishing property, we're going to next talk about a very interesting question. Let's say we share a courtyard and we didn't make an eruv before, so I relinquish my share of the courtyard to you, so you can use it, you can go in and out, and I can't. What if on Shabbat, then we switch? You would then relinquish your share of the courtyard back to me, and then I can start carrying. And if you do that, we can keep going back and forth. And whenever you need to carry something out, I'll relinquish to you. And then we can just go back. And that would be an easy way, not easy, a little bit annoying, but a serviceable way to be able to have everyone in the courtyard be able to carry, even though they didn't make an eruv. So can you do that? Can you change, re-renounce? Adav says yes, Shmuel says no. And we're going to try to correlate that machlok at the Moraim with two different machlokot of Tanaim about related topics. And we'll see if that works. And then finally, we'll get back to the Mishnah. It had a story about a Sadducee that was in the courtyard with Rabban Gamliel's father. And he said, to go and use the courtyard before the Sadducee does so that he doesn't take back his share of the property. So we'll discuss that one. Okay, so we start with the babies. And the first case of the infant where they didn't have water, they said, go ask a non-Jew to carry it because the sages in this case did not make an eruv. So regarding that, just on the fact that they didn't make an eruv, Amar le Rabba bar Rav Hanan le Abaye, mevo'a de'it be, tere gabre rabre be, Kerabanan, la lehevé be lo eruv lo shituf. So Rabba, the son of Rav Hanan, says, I can't believe Abaye, that you have two great sages living here in your city, Rabba and Abaye, and neither of you took the time to make an eruv or a shituf mevo'ot. I mean, this is an important thing to do because you're helping people, you're saving them from the prohibition of carrying, should they carry, and you're allowing them to enjoy Shabbat, bring food over to each other, carry their babies outside. How could it be that you didn't make the eruv? And so his answer is, Amar le, my navid, mor lav orche. What can we do? The master, Rabba, he's the elder. It's not going to be his way. In other words, he's too distinguished to go around and have to deal with this and go and ask everybody for permission and to contribute something. So he didn't do it. Ana taredna begirsai inhu la mashkachi. And I am busy with my studies. It takes time to go and make an eruv. And I couldn't waste any time doing this. And the other people, the other residents, they didn't care about it. Nobody asked about it. Nobody started a committee to try to do it. It's interesting. I wonder, what kind of people they were living with. What do you mean they didn't care? Because they didn't carry at all, or because, they were so scrupulous, or because they didn't care to carry without it? I'm not sure what that means. All right. Anyway, that's why they didn't do it. So now he's going to, v'yak ne'lehu pita besala. Now, you're going to ask, how about I just take some bread in my own basket. I don't have to go around and collect from every single person. In order to make an eruv, you can, the way we do it, right, is we just have two people, Rabbi Barry and some congregant, and he gives over the two boxes of matzah on behalf of everyone. All right, so we do it on everybody's behalf, so we don't have to bother going around collecting. So if you want me to do that, transfer some of my own bread on behalf of everybody else, I can't do that because I'm too poor. Because in order for it to be a real eruv or shituf mevaot, I have to be willing to share it with other people. So technically right now, if you go to the synagogue office and say, hey, I'm part of this eruv, I want some of that matzah, right? We have to give it to you. Then we'll have to do it again for next week, right? But, or we could just give you some. So because it's shared food, you have to allow everyone to do it. But Abaye was very poor and he didn't have an extra two loaves of bread to go and share and give other people. So maybe people wouldn't ask, but if they would ask, he wouldn't want to give it. And therefore, it would not be a valid eruv. So he can't use his own. Where do we learn this law from? From a braita. The Tanya echad mibnei mavoi shebikesh yayin vashemen velo natnu lo batel hashituf. Shituf mevot, joining many courtyards together, is usually done with wine. And if someone comes and says, hey, I'd like to drink some of that wine or use some of the oil, and if let's say they don't want to give it because it's expensive and you know maybe they want to leave it there for many weeks at a time, if they don't give it to him, then they're not really sharing it, right? You gotta share for it to be a real partnership, and then the eruv wouldn't be good. Okay, so that's why he didn't do it. Now we wonder further, the son of Rav Chanin, who's asking these questions, says, well, why not get just a little bit of vinegar? All you need is enough for two meals. Vinegar you don't drink, but you dip. So enough salad dressing for two meals. It's not very much, just like, 4 ounces of vinegar is not so expensive. And you leave it in the barrel so that you don't even have to take it out. So you it'll stay good in the barrel for a long time. You just put one barrel in a common area, and that'll be the eruv. And that way you don't have to, use up anything that's expensive for you. So Tanya and Mishtatefin Ba'osad says, no, I couldn't do that either because you're not allowed to use food from a storeroom, stored up food, for an eruv or for a shituf mevaot. Why? Well, because let's say I have a whole barrel. Let's say it has 100 ounces in it. So I'm saying 4 of the ounces in this are going to be for the eruv. Well, which 4? Well, I don't want to specify which 4 because I don't want to have to take them out. I want to leave it in the storeroom so that I can have it when I need it. And therefore, it's indistinct. So this, according to this braita, I have to have a distinct amount and say right here, the vinegar in this cup will be the eruv, not some of the vinegar in this giant vat. That's not good enough. And so that's why I could not make an eruv. All right, so that is his reasoning. That's Abaye's reasoning, explaining all the reasons why he could not make an eruv and he's too poor. But we have yet another question on him. You quoted a braita that says you're not allowed to use a storeroom, a barrel, for an eruv. But we have another braita that says you can use a barrel, something stored, for an eruv. So now we have a contradiction between these two. All right, we have to resolve the contradiction in any case. Madav Hoshaya Lakashya Habet Shamai Habet Hillel. These two Braitot reflect two different opinions. Bet Shamai that says you cannot use a barrel full, a storeroom, and Bet Hillel says you can. Okay, what's that? The essence of their controversy? And the essence is whether you have to have something distinct, right? The stuff in this cup, that's what's going to be my eruv, or that's Bet Shamai. Or Bet Hillel, who says, you can decide later, right? You could just say some part of this barrel is going to be the eruv. And then later on, after I drink some, after I open it, then I could say, okay, this was what I decided. And retroactively, that'll be so. Bet Shammai is being a little bit more literal, realist. And Bet Shammai is allowing for more of like a legal fiction that, we'll decide later, whichever one it will be, and that will happen retroactively. Okay, this this difference between Beit Hillel and Beit Shammai, we see in another case, we're deriving it from another Mishnah. There's a Mishnah in Masechet Ohalot, which says, "Titnan hamet babayit velo pitachim harbe, kulan teme'in." If there's a dead body in a house, so it's a dead body not only makes something else tameh by touching, but also anything in the house that's a cover over it. And not only that, also the openings. So I'll show you a picture, I'll make it clearer. So let's say there's a dead body inside this house, and this house has a lot of doors. I don't know why they have so many doors. This is, looks like escape the room or something. But in any case, it doesn't matter. It has two doors or three doors. And so the doorway, if you see doorways, have a covering. And so if I have a utensil in the doorway, so let's say the door is open, right? So that tum'ah is still here, hovering, and is under this covering. And so therefore the utensil is tameh, even if the door is closed. So the tum'ah is going to make the dead body is going to make the tum'ah is going to spread through all the doorways, because any of them could possibly be the one that will be used to bring the body out. Niftach echad mehen hu tameh v'chulan tehorin. But if I go and then open one of them, right, then obviously I'm going to use that one. So that one is tameh and the rest are tahor. So the closed doors, if one of them is open, the closed doors are simply barriers, they're walls. I'm not going to take the body out, so the outside of that doorway is fine, only the open one. That's if I actually open it. What about if I thought of it? Chishev lehotzi'o be'echad mehen, o be'chalon sheyesh bo arba'a arba'a, masil al kol petachim kulan. Even if I just say, you know what, I think I'm going to take the dead body out of that door, out of the side door there, then even if I didn't open it, just thinking about it, that becomes designated. A utensil in that doorway becomes tameh, all the rest are okay. That is the opinion of Beit Hillel. But Shammai omrim, behu shechishev ad shelo yamut hamet. Beit Hillel omrim, af mi sheyamut hamet. Beit Shammai says, that's only if I thought of it before the person died. The person's about to die. I said, oh, quickly, I better think about which door I'm going to take him out of. Oh, it'll be that door. And in that case, That door is designated before he died. So when the person dies and the tumah now starts spreading, it'll go to that specific door. Only the utensils in that door are tameh. All the rest are okay. But he has to think about it before the death. Beit Hillel says, even after the person dies, which is very interesting. So that means as soon as the person dies, I didn't designate any of the doors. Tumah will spread and all the doors will be tameh. But if a few minutes later, or an hour later, I say, you know what, I'm going to end up taking him out of that particular door. Then suddenly, retroactively, only that door is tameh, and the other ones are now designated as walls and not doors. So that's pretty cool that that this designation can work retroactively. And so too, in our case, where I say 4 ounces within this barrel are going to be the Eruv, and I don't specify which ones. Beit Hillel would say, that's okay. Even if a year from now, I end up opening the barrel and I take out these 4 ounces and I put them, I say, these are for the Eruv. And then I go put them on my salad. That is totally fine. Okay, this does not answer the question against Abaye, because according to this, Abaye was following Beit Shammai and saying he couldn't do it. I can't afford to use up a whole barrel for the Eruv. But according to Beit Hillel, he could have designated the whole barrel, and then, you know, later when he opens it, he could have. Maybe he couldn't even afford that. Okay, that is case number one of an infant. Case number two. Hahu yanokad de ishtapuch chamimeh. So we had an infant who required a circumcision on Shabbat, but the warm water that was used to bathe him was spilled out. And so we need to get warm water so that we can do the circumcision. Amar lehu Rava nishayelea le'ime isericha nachem le'goy agab ime. Oh, so he has a good solution. Let's ask the mother if she needs some warm water. A mother who just gave birth is considered chola, sheyesh basakana, because very dangerous. And so someone who is has the possibility of a life-threatening disease, we must violate Shabbat no matter what. In this case, this is already more than a week after she gave birth, So she might be a chola she en basakana. She is sick, but there's no threat of death. Even so, in this case, you're allowed to ask a non-Jew. You can violate the Rabbanan in order to help the health of such a person. And so therefore, let's ask the mother, hey, would you need some warm water? And if she says yes, hopefully she'll say yes, then we'll ask the non-Jew to warm up water for her. And while we're doing that, we'll add a little more for the baby. And that way we could use that loophole to warm water for the baby. All right, that seems like a good solution. Hold on, Rav Meshashia says, in that case, that mother was eating dates. Apparently dates is something that's difficult to consume and you have to be very healthy to eat dates. And so you're saying, the point is, she was perfectly fine. She wasn't sick at all. She was eating dates. She had perfect health. So we wouldn't be allowed to violate Shabbat, even midrabanan, and boil the water for her. And therefore, that would not be a good solution to get water for the baby. That's his challenge to Rava. Amar le, Rava answers, Emur tunva be'alma hu din katla. Says, just because she's eating dates doesn't mean she's well. It means that she's so unwell, she's just eating anything, even eating things that are bad for her. And so that's actually a proof that she is not well and she really needs this warm water. And that's why he permitted heating up some more warm water for the infant as well. Okay, and now finally, third case, same problem. Hahu yanoka tishtapuch chamimeh, the warm water that they prepared from before Shabbat spilt. Amalhu Rava, panu li, same shades. Rava, right? Okay, I guess in different cases he used different solutions depending on the circumstances. Panu li mane mi be gavri lebe nashe veezil veetev hatam. Ibtil lehu ha chaser. So there's a diagram here, but this is a better diagram. Okay, so the case was as follows. There's two courtyards that are adjacent. The baby was in this courtyard here. They had some warm water, but it spilt. So now it's not there anymore. And now they're on Shabbat, they want to do the circumcision, but the warm water, the water heater is here in this courtyard. So they want to be able to transfer from here to there. If they made an eruv, there would be no problem. They can simply carry it. But this is a case where they did not make an eruv before Shabbat. Now, Rava lives here. It's nice to have like a whole family joint courtyards. So Rava lives here. And now they can't share because these are two courtyards. So Rava says, listen, here's what I want you to do. I'm going to relinquish my right to this courtyard for them. Before I do that, I want to make sure that I don't carry. Once he relinquishes his right, he's not allowed to carry from his home to his own courtyard. So he says, listen, take all my stuff, I mean, anything that I might need, my books, my toothbrush, and bring it from the male section to the female section. Apparently in his house, they had a men's section and a ladies section. I'm not sure how common that was in homes, but maybe when they were slept, dressed, or hung out, they had two sections. So the woman's section was more in the back of the house for modesty. So he says, listen, I don't want to be right in front of the door because I might forget that I'm going to come carry out. So move all my stuff to the back. And that way I will relinquish my right to the courtyard. And then that courtyard can be joined up, can be given over to the people that live here. And then they will be able to go over here, take some warm water and carry it to the baby. And that's how they can do it. Okay, so if you notice, by the way, this is a case of relinquishing right from one courtyard to another, right? He wants to give the rights of this courtyard to people in the other courtyard, which we saw is controversial. And that's gonna be part of the discussion here. Okay, so that's what he says. Amar le Ravina le Rava, v'amar Shmuel en bitul reshut mechaser lechaser. Ravina asked him exactly that question. According to Shmuel, if we all live in the same one courtyard, single courtyard, then yes, I can relinquish my right and then you can use it. But when you have two courtyards, we live in two different courtyards, then I can't relinquish my right to this courtyard to you that you live, and when you live in a different courtyard. It doesn't work. You can't cross the wall, can't cross the boundary like that. So how could you do that? He has an answer. Amar le anak rabbi yochanan sevir ali damar yesh bitul mechaser lechaser. We saw this machloket before. Rabbi Yochanan says you can do that. Okay, good. So he follows Rabbi Yochanan. Okay, no problem. Ve'i la'sabar la'mor kishmuel yatev mor beduchte v'nivtil lehu leditu v'nihadru inhu v'nibatelu le'lemor tamarav mebatelin v'chozrin u'mebatelin. Oh, very interesting question. It says, if in fact you're not following Shmuel and you think that you can renounce possession from one courtyard to another, then I have a better idea for you. You don't have to move all your stuff from the men's section to the women's section. If you want to carry out, you can. Here's all you need to do is, after they carry the water over here, then the people that live here will then renounce their right to the courtyard back, and you can repossess your courtyard, and then you can carry. And then if they later want some more warm water, then you'll renounce your right again. And then they'll be able to carry. And you just, you know, just holler and say, hey, renounce your right. Okay, I renounce. And then they can carry. Since you don't follow Shmuel's opinion anyway, you'll follow the more lenient opinion of Rabbi Yochanan. Why don't you do that? And you don't have to move your stuff to the woman section. Okay, very interesting question. Right, Rav in fact said you can renounce and then go and renounce again. So follow him. Says Anna, Rav replies, Anna beha kishmuel sibidali damar en mebatelin vechozrin mebatelin. I agree with Shmuel on this point. I know I said I disagree on the other point about relinquishing from one. I think you can relinquish from one courtyard to another. I disagree with Shmuel, but in this, that you cannot go and re-renounce, that I agree with Shmuel against Rav. Okay, so Shmuel's in between. Shmuel disagrees with Rabbi Yochanan on one topic and with Rav on another topic. He agrees with Shmuel regarding this topic that you can re-renounce. All right, so, but is that logically consistent, however? Ve'lav hatamahu seems to be logically inconsistent. Why? My tama and mevatelin vechozin batelin la mishum dechavan de bitele lirshute istalek le mehachal legamre vaavale keben chaser acheret ven bitul reshut mehaser lechaser morname landibtil. What's the reason that? Why would you say you? I can't renounce. Re-renounce. It must be because you think that once I'm living here, I renounce my right to the courtyard. Once I renounce my right to the courtyard, then it's no longer mine. I don't even live here anymore. I mean, I'm physically here, but I have no place here. And so therefore, I have, even if you renounce yours, I cannot reclaim it because I'm not here anymore. Or rather, I'm here, but Shmuel says I'm not allowed to renounce from one courtyard to another. So I couldn't possibly redo it. And so that's the reason why I can't re-renounce, because I gave up my right to this, even my own courtyard. And so when you go back, if you try to renounce, I cannot take it back because you can't renounce my courtyard back to me, according to Shmuel. So his point is that if Shmuel is machmi, if you follow Shmuel on one, then you have to follow Shmuel on both, right? If you're going to be machmir, his reasoning that they depend on each other. Okay, so Rava responds, no, not necessarily. Hatam haynu tama ki hechi dela lehevem miletad rabanan kechucha ve'itlula. The reason I disagree with Shmuel, I think that you can renounce from one courtyard to another. But my problem with re-renouncing is not that I'm not part of this courtyard anymore and then I couldn't take it back. That happens to be true, but I have a different reason to disagree with Shmuel about re-renouncing, and that is that if you follow Rav and say I can re-renounce, then it's going to make the halacha into a joke, right? Oh, you're not allowed to carry here, but you can renounce. And then after you renounce and he carries, he re-renounces and you carry, and you go back and forth like this. Anyone who's coming to visit, like, what kind of halacha is this? This is silly. This is just a game. And we don't want people to make a mockery out of the law. And so that's the reason. Only because of more like a marit ayin. But essentially, according to the logic would work. So that's why he is not inconsistent. All right. So that concludes the discussion of the three cases of infants. And now we mentioned quickly this machloket. Can you renounce again? and back the other way. Rav said you can, Shmuel says no, you cannot. So we have a gufa. We're going to now quote this in full, and we're going to try to match it up with machlokot of Tanaim. Gufa, Rav amar, mevatelin v'chozrin u'batelin. Shmuel amar, en mevatelin v'chozrin u'mevatelin. Lema Rav Shmuel bepilukta de Rabbanan v'ribi Eliezer ka mipalge. It doesn't quote exactly what they say, but we have to fill it in. Okay, so the Rav Damar ke Rabbanan, Ushmel Damar ke Rabbi Eliezer. Okay, what is their machloket? They were talking about residents that forgot to join an eruv, and so then they do that. One of them renounces to the rest of them. The question is, what happens with that resident's house? The one who renounces himself, Rabbi Eliezer says that he cannot carry in and out of his house, but everybody else can come into his house. In other words, when someone renounces, he renounces his courtyard and even his home. He renounces it. He renounces everything, right? He renounces. The renouncer also gives up his house. By giving up his house, okay, he can stay in his house, but it means that all the other members of the courtyard can go from their homes into the courtyard, and from the courtyard even into the renouncer's house, right? Because it's not his anymore. That's Rabbi Eliezer. Rabbanan say that the renouncer retains the title to his own house. He only renounces his courtyard, but nobody's going to give up their own home, right? And say, and make it like, okay, everybody else can come in and make a sleepover party and start sleeping on his couch. Nobody would do that. So therefore, since he retains right to his house, his house is off limits. He cannot carry, and no one else can carry either into the renouncer's house. That's the machloket between Rabbanan and Rabbi Eliezer. So now we want to try to match this up by saying as follows. Well, can you renounce and re-renounce the other way? Well, Rav says, yes, you can. Why? Well, maybe because since I retain, even though I renounced, I retain the right to my own house, right? So then when you renounce the courtyard, I'm there. I have my house. I can take back my courtyard. Whereas according to the Rabbi Eliezer, that says I renounce everything, my house, my courtyard and my house, I have no place there. So when you go and renounce later on what I gave you, I have no foothold in order to get it back. Because I'm physically there, but I have no legal property there. I have no legal right to be there. So that would seem to match up. So does this match up? The answer is no, not necessarily. I think that you can renounce and re-renounce, and I can even follow Rabbi Eliezer, who says, I give up my house. Ad kan la ka amar Rabbi Eliezer hatam, ha-mevatel reshut chatzero reshut beto bitel, mishum de bebayit, I only said this principle that someone who gives up his courtyard, gives up his home, right, because they go together, and nobody's going to want to give up and have a home. He gives up his house also because no one's going to want to have a home without a courtyard. So therefore the home and courtyard always go together. So by renouncing, he renounces both. Yes, that's true. But it doesn't mean that I completely leave altogether. Listaluke, do I have to, be removed from it? I still have a legal, some physical presence there. And that is sufficient to regain my foothold. In other words, renounce my property to the extent that everybody else can come in and out. It's theirs. But I'm still there physically, and so I can get it back. And Shmuel says, I can also agree with both opinions of the Tanaim. He says that you cannot re-renounce. Ad kan la kamer Rabbanan hatam. Rabbanan say, I relinquished the courtyard because I said, I don't care about the courtyard. I didn't say anything about my house, so you can't come in and live in my house. But when I said the courtyard is renounced, I meant it. and the courtyard is not mine at all. And so therefore I have no right to go back and to go and take back the courtyard, because I already said it's not mine, and you can't go back on that. So Shmuel could be justified, both Rav and Shmuel could be justified according to both opinions. So they're related topics, but not they don't match up one to one. All right, so we figured we that was not a successful matchup. We like to match things up anyway, you know, because we want to just conceptually see, is this dependent on that or is it not? And if the Amoraim argue on something and the Tanaim also do, then it's nice. We have a nice symmetry that we can match up diverse things. So we're going to try again with a different machloket. Amarav achabad chana, amarav sheshat, kitana'e. Mi shenatan reshuto vehotzi ben beshogeg ben bemezid oser divrei Rabbi Meir. Rabbi Yehuda omer bemezid oser beshogeg eno oser. So again, case where they didn't make an eruv, but on Shabbat one of the people gave away his right, renounced his right to the courtyard, and then he carried in the courtyard, okay, either by mistake or on purpose. According to Rabbi Meir, doesn't matter whether he by mistake or on purpose, he prohibits everybody else. So he goes and says, "I relinquish my right," and then all of a sudden he's carrying his suitcase out to the out there. So that shows that he didn't really relinquish his right by carrying there. He unrelinquishes it. Okay, he's taking it back, and so therefore nobody else can carry there. However, according to the Biyuda, he says, "B'mezid oser, b'shogeg eno oser." If he did it on purpose, and he says, "Oh, I know I relinquished it, but you know what? On purpose, I'm going to go and carry something out." That shows he's actively undoing it. But if he did it by mistake, he just forgot and didn't realize, then it doesn't undo his relinquishing. He is in violation, because now he carried in a place where that wasn't his and he wasn't allowed to, but it doesn't undo the rest of it. That's the machloket that's found in the Mishnah in Masechet Eruvin, 6-4, later in our Perek. Okay, so now we're going to try to match that up with what Rav and Shmuel said. How are we going to do that? My love, Abehaka mipalge, demor savar, mebatilin, vechozrin, mebatilin. Omor savar, en mebatilin, vechozrin, mebatilin. So this seems to match up. The Bimeir, who says, any action I do, if I just go by mistake and I carry something outside, then that means I'm taking it back. Well, that would match up with the opinion that says that you can go and switch and re-renounce, right? This renunciation can go back and forth. It's easy to change. Whereas the other opinion that says en mevatelin v'chozin u'batelin, right? In other words, Shmuel, that would fit Rabbi Yehuda, because Rabbi Yehuda says only if I go and actively on purpose go out and do something, then it gets changed, but not otherwise. In other words, it's more difficult to change, and so those two opinions could go together. But we reject this as well. Both of the opinions in that Mishnah would agree that you cannot, the other party who received the courtyards cannot renounce it again. In other words, essentially, only someone who intentionally does it, and Rashi explains here that he intentionally carried something out before anybody else got a chance to go into the courtyard, right? In other words, as follows. He says, "I renounce the share to my courtyard." And everybody says, "Oh, Chazak Baruch, thank you so much." And he says, "Hey, why? I don't want to do that." So before anybody else gets a chance to take hold of the courtyard, he goes and he carries his food, talit, out there. And so by doing that on purpose, he's basically taking it back. But if it's just by mistake, or if other people already went and started using it, then he cannot take it back anymore. And so that would all fit with Shmuel, the opinion that says you cannot take it back. And so once again here, although we tried to match them up, they don't necessarily match up one-to-one. So this machloket between Rav and Shmuel is independent of the machloket of Tanaim. Last point about this, Rav Asher amar, Rav Shmuel b'pluta, Rabbi Eliezer v'Rabbanan ka mipalge. Going back to this one, he says, actually, This one does, between Rabban and Rabbi Eliezer, that does work. That does match up. According to Rav Asher, Rav and Shmuel are dependent on Rabbanan and Rabbi Eliezer. I know before we threw a curveball into that one, but Rav Asher says, no, I can resolve it. He doesn't say how he does, but he thinks that they do match up. Okay, so that's all for the topic of renunciation and re-renunciation. And now we're gonna get to the last section of the story at the end of the Mishnah. The story went as follows. Amar Rabban Gamliel ma'aseh besadoki, echad shehiyad dar imanu. There was a Sadducee, says, that lived with us in our alleyway. And one time he renounced his right to the alleyway. And then, we'll see the rest of the story in a second. So first we say, Sadoki mandachal shemeh. Wait, so what do you mean Sadducee? Nobody mentioned Sadducee beforehand that we would even know what the law is regarding a Sadducee. And all of a sudden you're telling us a story about him. Well, we need some background. So here's some background to explain. Hasure mehasera v'achikatani. This is the complete meaning or understanding or text of the Mishnah. Sadoki harehu kegoy. But Rabban Gamliel omer saduki eno kegoy. Okay, so a Sadducee. They are Jewish, right? Sadducees are Jewish by any definition, but they don't agree with rabbinic law. So what is going to be his status regarding an eruv? The first opinion, Tanakama, says he's like a goy. Not for all matters, but for this matter. Because just like a non-Jew does not believe in Eruv, he has nothing, the whole laws of Shabbat and carrying don't apply to him. Therefore, a non-Jew cannot join in an Eruv, right? And he can't even relinquish rights. And so the only way to deal with that is like a non-Jew is to rent his property. Rabban Gamliel, however, thinks differently. Even though the Sadducee does not agree with you, with your interpretation and the laws of Eruv, still, he is Jewish and the laws of Shabbat do apply to him. So he thinks that a Sadducee is not like a goy, and you can use the relinquishing of property. If he relinquishes his property, you can do that. Okay, now based on that, the story makes more sense. The Rabban Gamliel says, there was a Sadducee, Masim Sadduki Sheyadar Imanu, Be Mavoy Birushalayim, Ve'amar Lanu Abba, Maharu, Ve'osiu Ata Kelim L'Mavoy, Ad Shelo Yosi, Ve'yesor Alechem. And our father said, okay, we got the Sadducee to agree to relinquish the property. Quickly, take everything you need out to the courtyard before he does. Why? Well, if he says, I relinquish my rights, but then he goes and carries something out, well, then that he's undoing what he just said. And then we're stuck. We won't be able to do it. Rather, we should go get a foothold, take our stuff out. That shows he relinquished. We grabbed it. It's ours, and then we'll be okay. Then he won't be able to take it back again. So hurry up while he still agreed. Go and make the deal. All right, so now we understand the Mishnah, and we'll ask a question from my Baraita. V'hatanya, hadar im hanochri sadoki ubaitosi, hare elu osrim alav. Rabban Gamliel omer saduki ubaitosi enan osrim. So here we have a parallel baraita that says someone who lives with a non-Jew or a Sadducee or a baitosi. Baitosi is a term that's found only in rabbinic literature. Rabbi Harari wrote his dissertation about this group. They seem to be basically the same as the Sadducees. From whatever we know about them, they're interchangeable. Some people think that they match up with what Josephus calls the Essenes, because Baitosi might be a concatenation of two words, Bet Essiim, right? And since Essenes are never mentioned by the rabbis, and Baitosim are never mentioned by Josephus, but maybe they're actually the same group, just by slightly different spelling. Okay, in any case, they both are Jews who disagree with, who don't follow the rabbinic interpretation of Torah Shebaal Peh, and so they do not agree with the Eruv, and so the non-Jew and these two, they are osrin alav. They prohibit someone from, if they live in the courtyard, then you cannot make an Eruv. or do we tool? They're the same as a non-Jew. However, the Ban Gamliel says, enanusrin. No, they're okay. You can share with them. You can, they can do bitul, and then you can carry, unlike a non-Jew. All right, that's the same so far as what we said before. This is a little bit different. The story in the Mishnah said that when my father's house, there used to be a Sadducee that lived there. Now he's talking about his own house. And now it's not Rabban Gamliel's father telling him, but Rabban Gamliel telling his children, "Banai maharu vehotziu ma she'atem motziin v'achnisu ma she'atem machnisin ad shelo yosi ha-to'ev hazeh ve'yasod alechem shere bitel reshuto lachem dibrer b'meir." He told his sons, hurry up and take out whatever you're going to take out and bring in whatever you're going to bring out in before this horrible person does, and he will prevent you from doing it. That is the interpretation of Rabbi Meir. Okay, so that is basically the same. But Rabbi Yehuda is another version. Rabbi Yehuda omer b'lshon acheret maharu ve'asu sorchechem b'mavoy ad shelo techshach ve'esor alechem. He told him, go and prepare whatever you need in the courtyard. Whatever you need to do there, do it before Shabbat starts. Because once Shabbat starts, he is going to come out and start using it, and you will not be able to use it at all. Which means that, according to the Rabbi Meir, once the rabbis in the courtyard start using it, that's it. That's theirs, and it can't go back to the back to the Sadducee. According to the Rabbi Yehuda, the Sadducee can come out anytime on Shabbat and take back his right, take back his relinquishment. And so therefore, we have to actually use everything before Shabbat starts. So that's an important distinction. Rabbi Yehuda's version is a lot more stringent. So let's analyze this for a minute. Amar mor hotziu ma she'atem hotziin v'achnisu ma she'atem machnisin ad shelo yosi ha-to'ev hazeh lachem hazeh v'yosor alachem. We just quoted here what Rabbi Yehuda said. Lememra dechi mapeki inhu v'adar mapik ihu la'asar. So are you telling me that according to the Rabbi Meir, right, the first version, if they took out their utensils first and then the Sadducee took them out after, then it's okay. He does not make it prohibited, right? That would be fine. That does seem to be the implication here. But it can't be because we have a Mishnah. Which Mishnah? The same one that we quoted before, Mishnah Eruvin 6:4. That's what we're going to bring here as the contradiction. V'hatanan. Mishenatan reshuto vehotzi ben beshogeg ben min mezid oser dibrer bi meir. Anyone who gave permission and then he took something out, whether he did it by mistake or on purpose, he does prohibit them. And that's what Rabbi Meir says. So in other words, according to Rabbi Meir, if the non-Jew or the Sadducee carries something out on Shabbat, he will prohibit everybody else, no matter when he does it. And according to what we just said here, he said, you bring it out first, and once you bring it out, then even if he carries out, it's no problem. So that's the contradiction. Amar Rav Yosef, Ema eno oser. You know what, this Mishnah that looks like he permits, you have the wrong version. Instead of oser, it should be eno oser, right? Even if he carries something out, whether on purpose or by mistake, it's no problem. That's Rav Yosef's answer. And we'll end with one more answer. Abaye amad lakasha kanche cheziko b'nei mavoi b'mavoi kanche lohe cheziko b'nei mavoi b'mavoi. No, that the you can resolve it another way. Depends on whether the other rabbis, rabbinic Jews that live in the courtyard, whether they came first. If they go and start using it first and they take hold of the courtyard, then it belongs to them. And then the Sadducee who renounced has no right anymore to take it back. That's what he mentioned. That's what was in the Braita, the case in the Braita. However, the case in the Mishnah was talking about where the other members of the courtyard did not start using it. They were doing other things first. And then the Sadducee said, I renounce it. But then he started carrying it out. That in that case, since they did not grab hold of it, it's still up in the air. And in that case, the Sadducee was able to take it back. And tomorrow we'll see some more proofs and discussion of that distinction. Baruch Adonai Olam. Amen ve'amen.